So within Australia, we have a diversity of inland water ecosystems, rivers, so riverine kind of ecosystems. And even within rivers, we have different types of rivers. We have perennial rivers, so permanent rivers, and then we have more ephemeral kind of streams. And so they also support different types of ecosystems. From there, we have wetlands as well. So we have wetlands that often sit at the bottom of river systems, but also wetlands that sit through an actual catchment as well. And we have a range of floodplains and floodplain ecosystems. And so when you have a river that floods, it supports a whole lot of water-dependent ecosystems along the breadth of its floodplain. We also have groundwater ecosystems, and they're probably one of our least studied type of ecosystems. And so they sit, we obviously can't see them there in the groundwater, but they're very isolated systems and support a very unique biodiversity. And we have many unique ecosystems that are supported through Australia, and one of them, the largest kind of iconic ecosystem, is Lake Eyre Basin. So it's an inland draining basin. It's very much one of those iconic basins in terms of being a boom and a bust. So when Lake Eyre floods, it's a big flood event. You often have a boom in terms of fish productivity, a boom in terms of the number of water birds that move to the Lake Eyre Basin. And then after that period of the boom, you have a drying, a bust kind of period is what we call it. And so during the bust period, you have the drying up to kind of remnant creek areas, and it's those remnant areas that are really important for supporting your fish, and it's about supporting those fish through the dry times, through the bust times, to be able to get to that next boom. So humans have had a dramatic influence on our inland water ecosystems, and that extends back many years. An example of that is the Brewarrina fish traps, which are believed to be about 40,000 years old. And what they are is a series of rock culverts through a river system, and they were used by the indigenous people to trap fish and obviously eat those fish. Since the early 20th century, we've seen a large expanse in terms of water resource development in Australia, and that has been particularly in the southeast part of Australia. So irrigated agriculture is very important in terms of provides us with food. Irrigated agriculture in the Murray-Darling Basin provides a great proportion of our agriculture in terms of people being able to use the food that comes from that particular basin. And so the challenge that we have is, how do we start sustainably have our agricultural systems and meet the diversity of values that we have, particularly in the Murray-Darling Basin. So ensuring that we have a healthy working river, a healthy river in terms of it's ecologically able to function, and also be able to support communities and irrigation communities that are now reliant on the water resources within the basin. So what we've seen in terms of water resource development through many parts of Australia, and certainly through the southeastern parts of Australia, is that it's actually the changes in the flooding cycles that are starting to affect our ecology on those floodplains. So our floodplains are retracting, they're getting smaller in terms of their size, and associated with that, you have a change in your biodiversity and your flora and your fauna. Through restoration activities that we start to try and improve our wetlands and restore the impacts that we've seen through irrigation. And an example of that is looking at the Pica Lake wetland system, and that's in the Murrumbidgee. It's down in the Lowbidgee part of the catchment, so the lower part of the catchment. And the Pica Lake system was isolated from the river system for about 100 years. And so through development of irrigation infrastructure, as well as just development of roads, you saw no connection of water through to the Pica Lake ecosystem. And so what has happened in the last few years is environmental flows have started to be delivered to that ecosystem, and it's a restoration activity that's been undertaken. And what has been observed is a great boom in terms of you've had a lot of birds move into the area, you've seen fish move into the area, aquatic plants emerge from the soils, and it's a very nice little case study where we can start to see how best to restore our ecosystems after such a long period of dry. So with the challenges of climate change and water resource development, there's a real need for the science, and that science to inform how we can protect our inland waters and our biodiversity within our inland waters, but also how to also cater for the various uses of water within our ecosystem so we can do that equitably across our users of the water.